welcome to another broadcast from MindYourHealthCast.com. We finished up our series on the fatty acids, which I felt are extremely important. In fact, one of the most important changes that you can make in your life is discarding the fish oil and getting into the parent organic plant-based omega-3 sixes in particular, so that your body can flush out all the old bad oils and get it functioning well again. And I studied that for a long, long time, and I'm absolutely convinced of the importance. Likewise, today the broadcast that we're going to be talking about, I feel is of extreme importance. In terms of understanding body function and some of the major problems that we are dealing with today, I am calling the broadcast today, Man with Three Brains. Now, not a man with three brains, but man referring to mankind having three brains. Now, I know that might sound a bit bizarre, but I think by the time I get finished, it certainly will make good sense to you. But I can't help talking about man and brains because the movie that was out with Steve Martin called The Man with Two Brains, and he was a Dutch neurosurgeon, and his name was something like Van Hoot Hoot, and he fell in love with a brain in a jar. And so a lot of the movie is involving him trying to find a body to put the brain in that he fell in love with. So it was kind of a humorous story, and there's some funny twists in it. And of course, he became a well-known neurosurgeon because he invented putting a zipper on the back of the cranium so that if you had to work on the brain, you didn't have to cut through all the bones and everything. You could just unzip it. Okay, so to the serious side of this, there's many articles, of articles that have come out involving a second brain. There are several, but you know, obviously the world is not full of them. But there were two articles that, or more, that had come out talking about a second brain. Now, I'm saying that there's actually three brains, and so you can extrapolate from that that one of the different areas referred to as a brain, a second brain, is going to be the third brain I'm referring to, and one will be the second. So, there was an article came out, written out of the other side of the border, called The Three Minds of the Body, Brain, Heart, and Gut. And he says that since the dawn of civilization, humans have always expressed love, feelings, and emotional pain coming from the heart and basic feeling or intuition coming from the gut. Hence the expression broken heart or gut feeling. Rationalists and scientists have scoffed at these expressions, saying they are only metaphors, but recent researches suggest they may have had scientific explanations. And so it's true. It does seem that the heart and the gut have a mind of their own, and besides communicating with the brain about their activities, they also may be helping in brain development, reducing depression, and just increasing the level of well-being of a person. We will try to show in this essay how brain, heart, and gut minds work together to produce a happy person. So he breaks it down and he talks about the gut and the heart, and of course this is really what I had in mind. From having studied the human body and pathologies of the human body and functions of the human body and biochemistry, biophysics, pathology, physiology for years and years and years, I had come to that conclusion that there were, in fact, and the interesting thing about it is that they really do function as brains, because they not only are connected with the brain and receive information from the brain and the head, but at the same time, they also send information back to the brain. In fact, so much so that the whole brain and body are highly influenced by both of these secondary brains. In fact, you can cut the nerves from the brain to the heart, and the heart will continue to beat. And you can cut the nerves from the gastric tract from the brain, and the gastric tract will continue to digest and break down and absorb and eliminate the leftovers, even though it's no longer connected with the brain. So different people along the way have recognized that both of these have separate functions. But you know, even the brain is so fascinating, I mean the heart is so fascinating as it connects to the brain, that in doing research with the heart and heart tissue, they've actually separated heart muscle into separate heart cells. And each of those cells have a pulsation to them. Now the interesting thing is you can have them all separated from each other and they're all pulsing, not necessarily in synchrony, but they're all pulsing. But when you bring them to close vicinity of each other, they actually synchronize themselves and start beating in unison. I found that to be extremely fascinating. And all I'm saying is that there's a whole lot more to the function of the body than has been thought about by regular medicine or the regular establishment. Now, some people have recognized that if you're upset, it could create anxiety and accelerate your heartbeat. Or if you're really upset, you could create an ulcer in the stomach or in the small intestine or in the colon. But they never looked at it as though it's a two-way street, that they are actually interacting with each other. In fact, not only are they in terms of neural connection to and from the brain acting like that, but they also produce neurotransmitters. In other words, the heart actually produces neurotransmitters and some other neuropeptides that, like dopamine and serotonin and so forth. And there's actually a tissue that some people have thought are about the size of a cat brain that actually is a brain in the heart. But anyhow, they regulate. There were some studies done in Germany relating to the heart pacing the body via the brain in a lot of the rhythms. And it appears that the heart is very sensitive to the Earth's Schumann frequency, of which 7.83 is one of the base frequencies of the Schumann frequency. And so the heart is actually activated by the frequency, which in turn sends messages to the brain and the head to regulate all kinds of things within the body. Now, to me, this is all fascinating and also important because that we don't remember these relationships, and so we think if you've got something going on with the heart, then all you can look at is the heart, or if something is going on in the gut or the digestive system, then you only look there. And many do not think in terms of there being a feedback to the brain, and therefore the brain and the head being influenced by the other two. And I think it's extremely important, and as we get through this, you'll probably see why I'm thinking that's true. A long time ago, when I got into the field of medicine, and in particular into psychiatry, and I have mentioned before, I took a two-year program at Cleveland Psychiatric Institute that was tied in with Case University, College of Medicine, Department of Psychiatry, and learned a lot about psychosomatics, the effect of the mind on the body. And so that part, and in particular the heart, that's been known for a long time, that a lot of the heart issues are because of our bad thinking, and hence we overstress the heart because of that thinking. But as I say, we haven't thought about it being the other way. But over the years, as I studied more and more, it became more important to understand that relationship, that the two are working in harmony and are, in a sense, co-regulating each other. And the heart, of course, it's a very unusual organ, I would say. A friend of mine who is in that natural health field but came from the pharmacy field first has made the comment when he talked about cardiovascular system that he kind of had the reductionist mindset. He said, well, if you talk about the cardiovascular system, all you need to think about is a pump and pipes and valves. Meaning, of course, the heart's the pump, and the valves in the vascular system and heart are the valves, and of course the arteries and veins being the pipes. Now, that's a very simplistic approach, and of course a long way from the way it really is. But nonetheless, they do that. I mean, the blood is pumped, but there's a lot more going on and involved with all these. In fact, I guess I ought to mention at this point that being in Oriental medicine also, and having studied heavily into acupuncture and Chinese medicine, you find out very rapidly there is a emotional relationship with each of the organs and the body. And it just so happens that the heart is excessive anxiety or joy affect the heart. But on the other hand, if the heart gets upset, it can create anxiety and or excessive joy, which is the feedback coming from the heart back to the brain and the head. Now, the other organs also involve emotions. The liver is anger and irritability. The spleen is worry and obsessive thinking. And the lungs are sadness and anguish and depression. And the kidneys are fear. So each of those organs have an emotional counterpart, and that if you, for example, have a very upset kidney system, you can have a sudden extreme fear that has no rational basis. If the spleen is upset, you can suddenly find thoughts just going round and round, and you can't get rid of them, and everything seems to be worrisome. And so they both are interrelated with each other, the emotional state and the organ. Now, interestingly, however, if you treat in Chinese medicine, by treating that energy, you're going to improve both the organ and the emotional state. And so, as I say, anxiety is the big one connected with heart. And so if the heart is upset, you can begin to feel anxious, or if you're feeling too much anxiety, you can feel it in your heart. There's an interconnection. But because of the fact that it is the emotion, it has an emotional seat anyhow, which I think is a big player with it. I can relate it and correlate it to other systems. For example, there is a typing system of the emotions and personality of a person called the Enneagram. And I don't know how many of you have heard of the Enneagram. If you have not, you probably might enjoy looking into it. The word Ennea is from the Greek. It has reference to 9 different basic personality styles with some variations in them, but those are the basic personality styles. And people who have one of those 9 also carry with it a certain style of responding to others in the world. And the one that has to do with the brain and the head is the groups 5, 6, and 7, which are the mind groups. So whenever something comes up, a crisis or whatever, the first response is, what's this all about? I have to think about this. And so it's a mind response. And before you can have any emotion about it or any reaction, you have to think about it and try to put together what's going on. Okay, and so it's interesting that that's the brain and the head. Now, on the other hand, people who get very emotional, very angry, very happy, very whatever, those react from the emotional side first. So the first thing they do is get angry or get hurt or get whatever. And so that's an emotional response. And so that would correspond, those three, which are 2, 3, and 4 on that charting system, to the heart brain. And the third group, which is 8, 9, and 1, those are the gut reactors. And that would relate, of course, to the gut responses. And so it's interesting that those styles indicate where your emotional, or your, I shouldn't say your emotional, your reactivity to or response to other people or to situations in the world comes from those. So the gut reactors flash out first before thinking or before even an emotion is involved. They just lash out and do something. Those are those gut reactors. They might have suddenly just punched you in the face, and that would be the first reaction. If they had a minute to think about it with the mind side, they'd say, hey, that's not a good idea. That guy might punch me back, or I might be sorry for the consequences of having done that. And the emotional one would get all in a fluster emotionally first. They may go back to the mind eventually, but they're going to react first from that emotional. So it's interesting if you start to look at some of the correlations. I don't have time to get into it in detail. If you decide you might want to find out more about it, there's a lot of books out, but the two experts, I would say that you might want to go to. There's another one, but it's a lot more detailed and a lot more technical. One would be Helen Palmer out of California, any of her material, and the other would be Don Rizzo out of Pennsylvania, who recently, I find out, has died, but he had an organization, as far as I know, it's still operating, yet another partner in it. And they have a test that you can go online and take this test to give you an inkling of which of those 9 types you are. Very interesting. The system goes back for hundreds, if not a few thousand years. No one has been able to find the beginning, but it's been around a long time, and it's still out there today. Stronger than ever, at least in our country, because nobody knew about it for a long time. It was kind of kept hidden in the sense that one of the religious orders kept it because they liked the people thinking they had some special powers by being able to tell them a lot about the way they respond to things and about their personality by understanding which of those 9 styles or personality types that they were. And so I think it's pertinent, and it gives you a lot of insight into someone. If you knew one, number one, what their Enneagram type was, as I mentioned, Enneagram means 9. It's from the Greek, Ennea is 9. And so having those ways of understanding people, to me, I found to be very useful. And there are some people who do therapy systems that they use that as a basis to find out which type the person is. They know how they're reacting. Are they gut reactor, heart reactor, meaning emotional, or are they thinkers? We got to think about this first. And I would say, for example, that Albert Einstein fell in the mind reactor first. He seemed otherwise very laid back and very calm, but a lot was going on up here. Now, as I say, it's not to say that people who are mind reactors can't have emotions and they can't influence or at least do something related to the gut. But they're not. That's not their first response. The first response is always going to be in the head or mind. So it's important to me to understand all this in my dealing with people in terms of health problems and so forth. It's just good information to have. So this gentleman that developed this essay goes on to talk a bit more about it, about the heart mind. He said the heart's one of the most important organs in the human body. And so, interestingly, he said that the life starts when it starts beating 21 days after conception. So the heart is the very first thing to become active in a new conception that takes place. So from the beginning, the heart is starting to make things happen, and even the fetus reacts to the mother's heartbeat. There's ways that calming children down, or infants especially, if they're carrying on or crying, they have recordings of a human heartbeat and play it at very low level in the crib, and if the baby's fussing or upset, it tends to have a calming effect and settles them down. Because, as I say, they were used to 9 months being in direct contact almost with the heartbeat of the mother, and so it that was their first home. And their own heart started beating within 21 days of conception, so that's very important. Now, they also, that the heart has a tremendous amount of neurons. It's interesting, not as many as the brain and the head, but a lot of neurons, and as I say, makes a lot of neurotransmitters. So that means that for all practical purposes, by definition of a brain, the heart is a brain, and it has a lot of effects on the body. Again, the writer of this essay says the heart-mind interaction takes place both by electrical signals, meaning the neurological signals that are sent out, via the vagus nerve and through the neurotransmitters that are created there. And a lot of people just never would think of the heart creating neurotransmitters. Now, the heart is such an important second brain. It's amazing what happens. For example, I was reading about heart transplants, I guess being one of the first organs transplanted, and also now, of course, they're doing all kind of organ transplants, but the heart still is probably one of those main ones. And so what was interesting is that there is a memory within the cells of the body anyhow. Now, I've mentioned before about Candace Pert, who is one of the key players and the whole idea of the consciousness being through the whole body and the memory being through the whole body. And it became evident to me when I looked at some of the organ transplant people how important it was to understand this relationship. Now, the heart, I think, is probably the one that brings in a lot of memory from the person that the donor had, the heart donor. Their consciousness, part of it is in that heart, and because it's so powerful in terms of a heart type or a brain type reaction in the body, then I believe that it's important to make that relationship, that when you get a heart, it's going to make some changes in your personality. Now, there actually was a study done and a whole book written. Actually, it was a book written by a heart-lung recipient that after she received this person's heart, she started actually having a craving for chicken nuggets, which she had never had before, and a desire to ride a motorcycle, which she had never had before, and also dreams of some strange people she had never met before. And so consequently, she decides she's going to try to find out who the donor was for that heart, because it was kind of bugging her that this had happened. So she finally tracked down that her heart came from a 19-year-old young man who was a very, very devout motorcyclist, and who was actually addicted to chicken nuggets. In fact, he was killed in a motorcycle accident, and his jacket pocket was full of chicken nuggets. And so she talked to the parents of this son, boy, and found out that the people she was dreaming about were actually people out of his life. So when she got his heart and lungs, she actually got a chunk of his memory, both conscious and I guess unconscious because of the, affecting her dream state. And so this article was written called Original Research, Changes in Heart Transplant Recipients That Parallel the Personalities of Their Donors. And so they talk about some of the cases of this happening. And what I thought was fascinating, that it actually had some profound effects in some people. And so much so that they found that 2 to 5 parallels per case were observed between changes following surgery and the history of the donors. The parallels included changes in food, music, art, sexual, recreational, career preferences, as well as specific instances of perceptions of names and sensory experiences related to the donors. One donor was killed by a gunshot to the face, and the recipient had dreams of seeing hot flashes of light in his face, and this occurred periodically. All of this kind of points to maybe Candace Pert wasn't too far off. Now, I know of one case where a little girl received a heart from another girl, and this little girl had been murdered. And the girl who received the heart started dreaming of the person who had murdered the donor and was able to gather so much information from it that the police were able to track down and catch the murderer of the donor. Now, that's pretty powerful stuff. And I know it's not something you might want to think about, but as I say, it appears... I know in one case, this lady was saying that after her husband received a donor organ from a young girl, that he started laughing like a young girl and had all of a sudden changed his personality so that he was much more playful and childlike in his behavior than he wasn't before, that he was more straight-laced. So I think that... probably Pert is accurate, and you might want to read her book. I've mentioned it before. It's called Molecules of Emotions, and she has gone heavily into it. In fact, she received a Nobel Prize. And so I'm thinking that these heart transplants are indicative of the fact that that is true. Now, there is, as I say, a lot of cases in here, and... one in particular, which I, again, thought was kind of outstanding. And this one involves a lady getting a heart from another lady. And here's what the recipients had to say. Now, the recipient, of course, is the person who received the heart from the donor. You can tell people about this if you want to, but it will make you sound crazy. When I got my new heart, 2 things happened to me. First, almost every night, and still sometimes now, I actually feel the accident my donor had originally. I can feel the impact on my chest. It slams into me, but my doctor said there's nothing wrong with her chest. So actually, the lady... her chest hit against the dash of the car, and she was killed. And so this lady still can get that feeling. And she says, also, I hate meat now. I can't stand it. I was one of McDonald's biggest money makers, and now meat makes me throw up. So it changed her taste preference. Originally, she liked, in fact, loved McDonald's, and then now she can't even stand to eat meat. And she says, actually, when I even smell it, my heart seems to race. But that's not the big deal. My doctor said that that's just due to my medicines. I couldn't tell him, but what really bothers me is that I'm engaged to be married. Now, why would that bother her? She said, he's a great guy and we love each other. The sex is terrific. The problem is I'm gay. At least I thought I was. After the transplant, I'm not. I don't think I am anyway. I'm sort of semi or confused gay. Women still seem attractive to me, but my boyfriend turns me on. Women don't. I have absolutely no desire to be with a woman. I think I got a gender transplant. Now, here's what her brother says. Susie's straight now. I mean it seriously. She was gay, and now her new heart made her straight. She threw out all of her books and stuff about gay politics, never talks about it anymore. She was really militant about it before. She holds hands and cuddles with Stephen, just like my girlfriend does with me. She talks girl talk with my girlfriend, where before she would be lecturing about the evils of sexist men. And my sister, the queen of the Big Mac, hates meat. She won't even have it in the house. So here, not only was the diet changed, but even her sexual preference was changed. So I have no doubt that the heart is carrying information, or other organs carrying information into other people that receive them. Now, this is, to me, very powerful stuff. And, of course, the heart being a second brain makes a tremendous sense that if there is cellular memory, which I'm convinced there is, then the heart or whatever that organ is you get in some way changes you. Now, I heard about a case, and I read about a case in Australia of a 14-year-old girl receiving a liver transplant, and it changed her blood type to the type of the donor. In other words, that had to be a genetic change. And I have some ideas why this would take place, that there are factors in the blood that can affect even the genetics of the body. And I suspect that the liver she received had quite a bit of blood in it that was not flushed out. And so when she got that in her body, it made a change in her genetic. And we won't have time to get into those. I think I may have alluded to that before along the way in some of the broadcasts, but I think it's important to understand that receiving a blood transplant is capable of making changes in the person, because I've seen a study, and in fact I know the researcher, where a rabbit was altered by separating certain factors from the blood, which, as I say, we don't have time to get into, and injecting it into a second rabbit, and the second rabbit over a period of time changes physical characteristics to look like the first rabbit, and then they took some tissue from the first rabbit and transplanted to the second rabbit, and it accepted as though it were its own tissue. So there truly was a genetic alteration. So that can be an issue about having transplants that maybe people might want to think about. We don't have time to go into heavy detail on all this, other than to say the heart is a brain, has all the characteristics of a brain. It actually produces neurotransmitters and neuropeptides, and therefore affects us tremendously in the emotional areas pretty strongly. So getting an organ transplant can alter your personality, your likes and dislikes, and potentially even your gender preference, which is interesting to me. There's some implications with that, which we're not going to get into at this point. But I thought it fascinating that would happen. Now, it would be good if you want to dig into some of this. Like I mentioned, Candace Pert's book. There's some other books on the internet about the heart and the emotions and so forth. And there's another factor, and I'll bring it up, I guess, in our next broadcast, because we'll be talking about the gut a little more. You know, I don't really have time to go into all the details of the these connections, but you might want to read another book called The Second Brain, and this is in preference to the coming of the gut. This is called a groundbreaking new understanding of nervous disorders of the stomach and intestines. And so this particular researcher, and he's a well-known researcher from a major university and medical school, has written this book, and he's talking heavily about the gut as a second brain. And so it's a good book to get if you want to find about it. The book, A Change of Heart, a memoir, is about the lady who had the heart-lung transplant. Her name is Claire Sylvia, and so I was checking to see if that's available, and it still is, and you might find that interesting. There's another person that knew about all this stuff way back, and you might want to look at his work if you want some very basic background work, and that was Dr. Wilhelm Reich, R-E-I-C-H, who was a psychiatrist and an MD, a protege at one time of Sigmund Freud. They disagreed because Reich was into the idea of how the brain and the emotions can actually affect the physical body, which we've talked about psychosomatics, but how the emotional states actually cause chronic tension in muscles in the body. And that you can't get rid of those emotional things until you break those chronic tensions that became a part of your body, which he called body armoring. And he isolated 7 different bands starting from the head down through the body. So why am I saying all this? I'm saying it because I want you to understand, again, that the body is a total unit. It's not a box of pieces. And that things that affect one part affect all the other parts. And in several different ways. But in this case, we're talking about 3 different brains. And yet they're all working in synchrony. But a disturbance in one of these can lead to other disturbances, not only in the brain in your head, but ultimately to the other brain, whether it's the heart affecting the gut or the gut affecting the heart, and both one or both of these affecting the brain. Tremendously interesting material and something to know, because especially when we get in the gut, a lot of some of the major problems today are very heavily involving the gut and our moods. And so we're going to get into that into our next session. Now, I see that we, as usual, run over, but I thought that it would be very important to look at because this interrelationship is so important to me, and you have to take it into consideration. And you have to take into consideration what happens to you as a whole if you affect one of these areas in an adverse way, or how it will improve the mental state, the emotional state, all kinds of things if you improve one of these areas. And so, as I say, in my therapy, in my clinic, we're looking at all this, and we'll give you some of the information in the next broadcast about how the gut can become such a major player, and some of the controversy about it, which people don't like to hear because they like it to be clear-cut. But I think one of the biggest areas that we're talking about is psychiatry and how it's practiced today, and modern medicine, how that affects both of these. So anyhow, I guess I've given you something to think about. Don't forget, man and his 2 brains, besides the one in the head. So in essence, a three-brain man. So at any rate, we will talk to you again, finishing this up in the next broadcast, and I hope this is provocative enough to get you started thinking of what all the implications are. And until the next time, go to our website, mindyourhealthcast.com, and we're putting on a page on the fatty acids I mentioned. We're going to have the new ones ready. because I intend to use them with all my patients. And then after we finish all this, I'm going to introduce you some new material I think you'll find extremely fascinating, as I hope most of the material I bring you is. We try to bring you on the cutting edge of what's going on in the world, not just here in the U.S., but in the whole world, related to health and well-being. So until our next broadcast, be healthy.